AquarianRadio.com.
Aloha, this is Enki. You know me as Aquarius, and this is our age, the Satayuga. Time to celebrate with us. We have programs on all chakra tantra, love styles and relationship choices, counseling strategies and techniques that you can use at home. We have extraterrestrial radio where we deal with alienology, paranormal people, and we have an experiencers network. We have a section called Ancient Aliens, and the programs therein are Enki Speaks, Nimma, the Mother of Humanity, has her program, and we revise ancient anthropology. And most important of all, we have peace paradigms. Because this is the age of peace, harmony and understanding, sympathy and trust abounding. No more falsehoods or derisions, golden living dreams of visions, mystic crystal revelations, and the mind's true liberation.
This is Enki.
It is I who 300,000 years ago created your race, and 200,000 years ago, it was a lot of fun, made it even better with some of the pretty girls. And it is I who saved you from the flood, and it is I and my beloved Nimma and my son Ningxiga Thoth who are here to help you overcome my runaway son Marduk or Allah, my brother Enlil or Yahweh. And free yourself from all the supposed gods and recognize your own great potential. You have much to teach us. And we, Anunnaki, those of us from Nibiru, welcome full partnership.
And here are your hosts, Janet and Dr. Sasha Lesson.
Aloha. Welcome to Aquarian Radio at AquarianRadio.com. Today's show is Enki Speaks. The title of today's show is Abraham. ET's dictated, ET dictated cuneiform clay tablets. This is on web radio, Enki Speaks, episode number 33, with articles, illustrations, YouTube on our sites where you can find these articles and YouTubes, and more explanation of this episode are EnkiSpeaks.com and AquarianRadio.com. Before we get into Sitchin's research on relation of the patriarch Abraham and the E.T. Enlil, who pretended to be a god called Yahweh, we're going to put this episode in the context of the story we've already told. And you can hear this anytime in the archives on AquarianRadio.com and EnkiSpeaks.com. Of the Nibirian ETs on Earth. But one more thing I forgot. This is Janet Kira Lesson, your host. And your co-host is Dr. Sasha Lesson. And it is Sunday, March 10th, 2013. And we are broadcasting live from Maui, Hawaii. Go ahead, Dr. Lesson. Take it away.
Oh, Zechariah Sitchin translated clay tablets that scribes wrote in ancient Sumer. And these clay tablets said that giant people from the planet Nibiru came to Earth to get gold. They were getting the gold to refine it into white powder of monoatomic gold, and they wanted that monoatomic gold to spread in the atmosphere of their planet Nibiru as a shield to keep the planet shielded from the elements as it went through its 3,600-year orbit when it comes through to Earth between Mars and Jupiter. Well, anyway, 300,000 years ago, when the miners from Nibiru mutinied here on Earth, Enki, their chief scientist, inserted his genes into the genome of a local human, Homo erectus. And Homo erectus had been around for a long time. It was the survivors of an ancient extinction event on Earth. And when Enki put the Nibiran Homo sapien genes and the Homo erectus genes together, he got us, the slave race. That's our genetic heritage.
13,000 years ago, Nibiru neared and warmed Earth and the Antarctic ice sheet slid toward the South Sea. The extraterrestrials knew the worldwide deluge would result, but Enlil, their commander, decided to let all of us hybrid Earthlings drown. But Enki managed to save his hybrid sons, Ziusudra, which we know of as Noah, Enlil decided the Nibirans would rule as Earthlings through Noah Zeezudra's descendants. Excuse me. Enlil's faction nuked their own spaceport on the Sinai Peninsula in 2024 BC, rather than let Enki's son Marduk and his Earthlings, the Babylonians, take it. But they accidentally decimated their own Earthling subjects with radiation.
Now, Abraham slavishly obeyed Enlil, the Nibiran commander. Enlil had a vision, but he didn't tell anyone that and the vision was from someone he saw at Skal Zu, a representative of the creator of all. And in the vision, he was told by Galzu to choose Abraham as general of his cavalry. Abraham was descended from the central line of the Homo erectus, Nibiran Homo sapien ancestors. He was, what happened is the head of the science mission, Enki, kept on impregnating his daughters and the daughters of the daughters and the daughters of the daughters till they got this line, which was their favorites. And Abraham is from that line. The Nibiran scientists on Earth then decided they were going to use the descendants of Noah, Zeezudra, the one that Enki and Galzu had saved from the deluge, to run the other humans, because the humans just multiplied so fast. There were millions of humans at some times, and there was only less than 1,000 of these people from Nibiru. And so they went beyond just being mind slaves. We were trained to work in their temples, their gardens, their harems, and their armies. Abraham directly descended then from this central line of Enki's son Noah, Zeezudra, and then Zeezudra's son Shem.
Enlil chose Abraham, a royal of Ur, who had married his half-sister, Princess Sarai, her name was later changed to Sarah, as his principal earthling agent. Abraham descended from Zeezudra's son, Shem. He was perfect to reestablish Enlil's rule of Canaan, protect the Sinai, and rule the Hamites.
Yeah, so before he had just been Abram, and so now that Yahweh, Enlil is putting him in charge of the descendants of Ham. His name isn't just Abram, it's Abraham, because he's supposed to rule those guys in Canaan too. really depended at that time on trading with the Hittites. And so Haran straddled the trade and military land routes to the spaceport on the Sinai too.
And they gave Abraham lands and riches until he was the richest man of his time. In 2048 BC, Enlil then ordered him to Canaan and to save Sinai. The commander brought Abraham the best, he bought Abraham the best chariots, finest horses, 380 well-trained soldiers, and weapons that could smite an army of 10,000 men in hours. Enlil sent Abraham, who was then 75 years old, and his nephew Lot to the Negev dry lands bordering the Sinai.
So you understand that besides just having cavalry, this guy had artillery weapons that were just way beyond what anyone could stand up to. In 2047 BC, Enlil dispatched Abraham and Lot to Egypt for more men and camels. Abraham's wife, Sarah, was very beautiful. He asked Sarah to say to the Pharaoh that she was only his sister so that the Egyptians wouldn't kill him and take her. That's what he said. That's what how the Bible rationalizes it. The Pharaoh thought Sarah was beautiful and showered Abraham with gifts of livestock and servants so that Abraham would give him Sarah to marry. And Abraham complied. Well, here she is. And the Pharaoh put her in the harem. Well, this really enraged Enlil. So Enlil sent a plague, and as he loosed plague germs on Egypt to punish the Pharaoh for taking Sarah, because Enlil wanted Sarah for his own breeding purposes. We'll get to that. So he sends this, he puts plague germs out, and the Egyptians are all dying. What happened is Abraham had told the Pharaoh that Sarah was his sister, and which is true, but had not told him that Sarah was his wife. So when Sarah learned that Sarah was Abraham's wife, he gave her back to Abraham. Take her back. Pharaoh was afraid that Enlil would loose more weapons and plagues and stuff if Abraham stayed in Egypt. So he gave Abraham, he gave her a princess, Hagar. Here, take this princess as your second wife. And then Pharaoh said to all of them, get out of Egypt and take all the money with you and take Princess Hagar too. She'll be your second wife.
In 2041, with this force, Abraham blocked the Elamite cavalry, which was trained by Enlil's champion, Ninurta, from the spaceport. The Elamites had overrun Sumer and captured Abraham's nephew, Lot, while Ninurta worked with his brother, Adad, Viracocha, and they were in Peru, where they built an alternative Enlilite spaceport at Nazca. Abraham rescued Lot, whom the Elamites had taken hostage. So the Elamites were retreating west of the Jordan River, and they had taken Lot hostage. And they rewarded Abraham for controlling Canaan. The commander promised Abraham many descendants, although Abraham was 86 years old at that time. But old Sarah just couldn't conceive with him. So Sarah told him to beget a child with Hagar.
In 2047, BC. I seem to have repeated the same paragraph. Well, I'll skip it. No, you don't need to get it twice. Let me turn pages here.
Okay,
here we go. So, right here.
Right here. Yeah. Okay. Our script's a little bit screwed up, but here we go. After the Enlilites nuked Sodom, Gomorrah, Admah, Zeblun, and the Salt Sea, Abraham moved to Canaan, but to avoid... Who's that? God?
Abraham wanted to avoid overlooking these cities.
Hills
that he had caused to be bombed and the people all killed, and he was just OD'd on realizing what a murder he had participated in.
Oh, okay. So he wanted to avoid overlooking the region that he had bombed. So he moved south to Gerar.
Yes, exactly.
Which was realm of the king Abimelech. Love these words. Okay. Hold on. This is my part. Abraham told Abimelech, as he had the pro-Enlilite Pharaoh, that Sarah was his sister. He's got a pattern here. So Abraham's concern was not because Sarah looked like a young beauty at 90 years of age. It was because Abimelech was one of the richest and most influential men of the region. In that day, a harem was more of a political statement than a romantic statement. However, Enlil made Sarah infertile, and though she lived a while in Abimelech's harem, she didn't conceive. So Enlil visited Abimelech in a dream, told him the truth, and acknowledged Abimelech's innocence. Abimelech complained to Abraham, who said he didn't exactly lie, since Sarah was indeed his half-sister. The commander made Abimelech restore Sarah to Abraham. Boy, Abraham just tried to get rid of Sarah. So Abimelech apologized to Abraham and gave him livestock and servants. Okay. The king told Abraham to reside anywhere in Gerar. Abimelech also gave 1,000 pieces of silver, livestock, and servants to Abraham. So wait a minute. So Abraham told Abimelech a lie, but Abimelech paid him off.
When Abimelech realized that Abraham was the guy that could ask Enlil to smite everybody and give him, he just said, take the money and go. Or you could stay here, but just please don't make Enlil kill me and everybody.
Yeah, because they already witnessed that one with the plague. The Pharaoh had a plague. Okay, so when Abimelech's men took the well at Beersheba from Abraham, he complained to Abimelech, who apologized. Abraham then set aside 7 ewes as witness that he dug the well.
That was his well, yeah.
That he dug his well. So Abimelech made Abraham swear an oath of non-aggression towards him and his family, to which Abraham agreed. Abraham planted a tamarisk tree there in the memory. Okay, that's okay. Good. So he learned how to work it out.
Of the earthlings loyal to the Enlilites, that is, the ones that served Ninurta, Nanar, Adad, Utu, and Inanna, only Abraham and his army survived. All the other guys, the other Nibirans, their earthlings, had all died either in the bombing or mostly in the radiation. So the only ones loyal to the old order, to Enlil and his lineage, was Abraham and his army. His band lived because Enlil had sent it to the Negev and then to Canaan to guard Sumer from Marduk's forces in Egypt and Lebanon. Now, Enlil wanted his surviving earthlings, Abraham and company, branded. So he ordered Abraham, now this is, Abraham is now 99, and his male followers to cut off their foreskins. And this would make their phalluses like those of the Nibirans and mark them as loyal to the Enlilites.
So, ouch.
Yeah, he's basically, this is the branding. You and everyone that's my human, circumcise yourselves. And then, in return, this is from the Bible, unto thy seed have I given this land, from the brook of Egypt, the Nile, until the river Euphrates, as though it was his to give.
And that branding is going on to this day. Wow.
Yeah, it is. It's an amputation that a child has no chance to say yes or no to. It's you can see where this barbaric custom began. It began with this megalomaniac Enlil wanting to brand the people that were loyal.
Yeah, so it's just like cattle branding.
Absolutely. We were animals to the Anunnaki.
Wow.
We are useful, or we could be killed. They have no feelings for us. Not all of them. Especially Enlil, and especially Marduk.
Abraham's aged principal wife and half-sister Sarah thought herself too old to conceive an heir for Abraham, so she told him to beget a child with Hagar, the Egyptian princess that the Pharaoh had given him. So he did, and Abraham raised Ishmael, the son Hagar bore, as his heir, due, all thought, to rule Canaan. But Enlil altered Sarah so she could conceive, following the Anunnaki preference for men to marry their half-sisters. The boy Sarah would bear, Enlil told Abraham, must replace Ishmael, Abraham's son he had with Hagar.
In 2025 B.C., Sarah bore Isaac in Canaan. She told Abraham, when she bore Isaac, get rid of that slave woman. her son shall never inherit of my son Isaac's share. Well, Enlil agreed, yes. He told Abraham, heed Sarah, your descendants shall spring from Isaac. Ishmael, son of the maidservant too, shall a nation beget, for Ishmael too springs from you. Enlil told Abraham, evict Hagar, you must. Enlil thus tested Abraham's loyalty and drove a wedge between him and Hagar. You got to choose, Enlil was saying, between me and this beautiful princess who you thought was your queen, and get rid of her and the son who was you thought was your heir. Well, Abraham fell in line again. He gave Hagar bread and water and a skin. He left her and Ishmael in the Beersheba woods, wilderness. When the water in the skin was gone, she put Ishmael under the bush, one of the bushes. She thought, I cannot watch the boy die. But no sooner had Hagar been left to die in the desert than Enlil, Yahweh, rescued her. He showed her a well, saved her and Ishmael, and won her undivided loyalty. And Ishmael became the genitor of the Arabs, who to this day compete with the descendants of Isaac for Canaan.
When Isaac grew the apple of old Abraham's eye to adulthood, Enlil decided to test whether Abraham still obeyed. Enlil told Abraham to take Isaac to a distant mountain far from the eyes of others and murder him in cold blood. Better there were no witnesses around to add to the growing discontent among humans to the gods. Abraham and Isaac came to the place Enlil told him. Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood and bound the son Isaac and laid him on the altar atop the wood. Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But an emissary of Enlil appealed and said, do not stretch out your hand against the lad, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son from me. Because you have not withheld your son, indeed I will greatly bless you, and I will greatly multiply your seed, and your seed shall possess the gate of their enemies, because you have obeyed my voice. Boy, that guy, and though he just said, here, kill your son. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, and in the version that we have a YouTube of that is attached to the article on this program, we have the version from the Quran where Isaac said, Dad, do it. Show, I'm with you. You know, you've got to show God you love him. So tie me up so I won't jerk around. So he was very obedient too. Anyway, Abraham had passed the test. He'd do anything the megalomaniacal Yahweh Enlil asked. Enlil told everybody about his favorite earthling, Abraham. Tribal chiefs, kings, and priests came to curry Abraham's favor and suck up to him to avoid his patron's acts of vengeance.
Okay, so next time on episode...
Well, wait, we're going to read.
We're going to read. So we're going to take a little break right now so we can get situated. So we'll be right back in a moment.
We'll be right back.
Aloha, we're back. This is Janet Kerr-Lesson with my co-host, Dr. Sasha Lesson, on Aquarian Radio at aquarianradio.com. We are in the middle of Enki Speaks. Our show is Enki Speaks. The title of today's show is Abraham, E.T. Dictated Cuneiform Clay Tablets. And now we're going to read from this incredible book called Slave Species of God, The Story of Humankind from the Cradle of Humankind by Michael Tellinger. And Dr. Lesson is going to begin.
So Enlil, or Yahweh, especially after the threats by Marduk, needed to find a faithful, obedient, strong human leader to oppose the growing armies of Marduk. His main objective was for Abraham to defend the spaceport on Sinai. So he had Abraham depart from Haran, where he was now going to work for Enlil. Well, Marduk is arriving on the scene, and Abraham and his nephew Lot become spies for Enlil. They report on the activities of Marduk. So here we have one so-called god, Enlil, demanding obedience, the other one threatening punishment and retribution for disobedience. And it's, Enlil and Marduk are like mirror images of each other. They're just so obsessed with fighting each other that they don't care about humans. Now, the human tribes belong to different gods, and they were commanded and controlled by these so-called gods. And of course, they were just big people from Nibiru. The main protagonists in the holy wars of the Bible were really the followers of Marduk and the followers of Yahweh, Enlil. The new slave species became the tool of wars for these Nibirans. Marduk summoned all the Anunnaki to his beloved city of Babylon, and he told them, "Now it's time for you to appoint me as ruler of Earth." Well, Marduk settled in Babylon. He took control of the whole known world, ultimately. Egypt, Israel, Canaan, Assyria, Akkad, Sumer, all after the evil wind, the nuclear fallout, and the bombing, became loyal to Ra or Marduk. That's who we were still stuck with in many ways.
So Abraham, a loyal general of the Lord Enlil, equipped him with the best chariots, along with the finest horses. He fought many battles, defending the spaceport in the Sinai, which was out of bounds to all humans. Abraham had a crack squad of some 380 well-trained and well-armed soldiers for the task. The weapons provided him by his God were so awesome. Everyone was petrified. Enlil, the supreme Anunnaki commander on Earth, whose command was under threat by Marduk. Angels came to Abraham, inquiring about the behavior of humans in certain cities. They used Abraham and his nephew as informants to gain information about the activities of the followers of Marduk. And this was in Sodom and Gomorrah. Under Marduk's control, from there he would marshal his large number of human followers and take control of all the establishments on Earth, including the spaceport of Enlil. So there was a decision was made to use, therefore, the weapons of terror on all of Marduk's people. And this was similar to the preemptive strikes that we do on Iraq. Marduk was in charge of Egypt, the Sinai Peninsula, with the spaceport was just east of him. And Sodom and Gomorrah were just north of the Sinai. And they were positioned to launch an attack on Enlil's spaceport. But only Enki was opposed. Ninurta, son of Enlil, and Nergal, son of Enki, were chosen the evil thing to carry out. The same angels who then proceeded to Sodom to destroy it, they were the same angels that proceeded to Sodom to destroy it with nuclear weapons.
Yeah, it was Ninurta and Nergal.
Your mic, honey. Go ahead, say that near to your mic, they won't be able to hear it.
The so-called angels were Nergal, the turncoat brother of Marduk, and Ninurta, Enlil's champion, and they went to see their spies, Lot and Abraham, and say, well, should we bomb these? Should we? Are these cities traitorous to us? Are they going over to Marduk? And as you'll see, this leads to them being destroyed terribly.
So Nergal and Ninurta were known as the angels of the Lord, but the Lord is just Yahweh, and they were no angels. The deadly weapons were retrieved from their secret places, and Enlil revealed to the Anunnaki how the weapons from their deep sleep to awaken. Abraham was a spy, so when Enlil tells his two fighters to make sure that Abraham is forewarned. So Abraham's going to get forewarned about the upcoming nuclear holocaust. So this was in 2064 BC when the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah occurred. Enki was mortified.
Yeah, there's different dates. Sitchin says it's 2025, and so we're not sure about exactly when.
Yeah.
That precise.
Okay. So Enki was mortified. And let's see, the verdant valley where Nabu, the people, was converting. So Nabu's Marduk's son, who was also a target. And there they annihilated five more cities with fire and brimstone. They were upheavaled, and all that lived there to vapor was turned. Okay. The Anunnaki did not expect it to be so devastating. The nuclear wind was distributing the deadly dust everywhere, including in their direction. There was no place to hide the evil wind. It rapidly moved toward Sumer. Ninurta and Nergal sent an urgent message to Enlil and Enki. Escape, escape, to them they all cried out. In the streets, the corpses piled up. The Anunnaki were not only using nuclear weapons, but biological weapons as well. But then came the incredible miracle, which was seen by Enlil in a dream, sometime before the event. All the lands were covered and destroyed by the evil wind, covering them from west to east, all except Babylon, where Marduk supremacy declared. And by the evil winds he was spared. This was perceived as a miracle by Enlil and everyone else among the Anunnaki. They declared that Marduk to supremacy has been destined. So they saw this as a miracle and that it was ordained that Marduk, it's a sign that Marduk was going to be supreme. And there was no other possible explanation in their eyes. So they slowly made plans to disperse, leaving Marduk to rule. Okay, one moment.
So, the God Master setting up his slave for personal sacrifice. Okay, this is a little part that Michael has told us to read about Abraham. And so, Abraham, his mistress is Hagar. This is Michael's version of things. Abraham's wife, Sarah, supports Abraham having a kid with Hagar. But Hagar is a real threat to her because she's given birth to a son to Abraham who will become a competitor to her own son in time to come. And so Enlil tells Abraham to evict Hagar personally. And by doing this, the master tests his slave's loyalty and drives a wedge between him and his mistress. No sooner has Hagar been left to die in the unforgiving desert than the master god, Enlil, comes to the rescue of the evicted young slave girl and her newborn son, winning her undivided loyalty and spreading the word of what a loving and benevolent god he is. He says, I will make the son of maidservant into a nation also, because he, Abraham, is your offspring. Tellinger says, this manipulation showed the gods that Abraham was extremely loyal and trustworthy in performing future tasks, and it made Hagar eternally indebted to Enlil for saving her and her son's lives. This was, however, not enough of a test of obedience for the future top spy of the gods, Abraham, before they could entrust Abraham with a full army of well-equipped men, chariots, advanced weapons, large stretches of land, and wealth beyond belief. They had to devise a test of ultimate obedience, which they did. Abraham is ordered by Enlil to take his son Isaac onto a distant mountain and sacrifice him to the gods. So this is what Tellinger calls this premeditated maliciousness. Better that there were no witnesses around or confused relatives to add to the growing discontent among the humans toward the Nibirans. Abraham passed the test. Now ready to perform any task for the conniving gods, the gods made sure that everybody knew their favorite boy, Abraham. He was the one they favored. Many tribal heads, kings, and even priests came to seek his favor and in truth suck up to him and avoid any possible acts of the vengeance of the gods.
So this manipulation of early man by the gods to establish loyalty provided the model for the gods with which they could exercise future control over their human subjects. So we need to recognize the absolute fear under which the people lived at all times. The gods were bloodthirsty and ruthless manipulators. So man had grown visibly unhappy with their abuse, and man was beginning to form groups of resistance, which were led by rebellious gods like Marduk, the son of Enki. Marduk had officially revolted against his commanding god Enlil, developing a huge global following among humans, as he promised them life after death. He proclaimed himself as God above all. People who were thought to be in any way involved in such activities against the ruling gods would be classified as vile and evil, and they would be punished severely. Marduk, as he grew more and more desperate to take control of the world, Marduk devised his own plan to control his human worshippers with fear and intimidation. Marduk traveled the whole world wherever other gods had settled, proclaiming himself as God above all. And so began the calculated, recorded manipulation of humankind by the so-called God of Vengeance of the Old Testament. Early activists against Enlil would congregate in places where they would not be easily spotted by potential gossipers and spies. The resistance kept on growing among the humans, and activists were plotting various ways to overcome the brutal gods. Certain towns and cities became strongholds of the early revolutionaries. Two of these cities were Sodom and Gomorrah. Humans were growing increasingly unhappy with their gods, and resistance was gaining momentum. Abraham and his followers were constantly manipulated and brainwashed by the gods with stories that the world was full of sinful and evil people. This kind of annihilation is pretty much what George W. Bush did in Afghanistan and Iraq. The kind of annihilation that describes the events at Sodom and Gomorrah was much more malicious, with a clear intent to kill all living things in those two cities.
Abraham became a highly dubious person. Even kings started to suck up to him in anticipation of the gods' possible retaliation against them. His nephew Lot, delivering the information to Abraham, in turn conveyed to the gods and angels when they came snooping around. They were spies. They were there. Tellinger says it's a cunning plan by the gods to send Lot right into the heart of Sodom and settle him down there, provide his uncle with information about the growing movement of resistance that was going on in these cities on the south end of the Salt Sea. So we get a real picture of Abraham. This is the covenant with Abbe Melchick, the second guy that Abraham offers his wife to. It's from the Bible, from Genesis. And it came to pass at that time that Abbe Melchick and Pichol, the commander of his army, spoke to Abraham, saying, God is with you in all you do. Now therefore swear to me by God that you will not deal falsely with me and with my offspring or with my posterity, but that according to the kindness that I have done to you, you will do to me and to the land in which you have dwelt. And Abraham said, I swear. So he's reassuring Abimelech that he'd put in a good word for him to God. That's what that passage means. And he's saying, I'm a snitch for gods, and you better pay attention to Yahweh, because I've got his ear.
Everyone was very nervous of the tenuous situation in the land, expecting something major to happen. There was much activity with gods coming and going all the time, appearing to various people, giving instructions and inflicting harm to potential enemies. There was a lot of activity among the revolutionaries, and they were called evil and vile and sinful men everywhere. So there was paranoia in the tone in which the accusations kept recurring. The people and the kings of the lands also knew Abraham's close relationship with the brutal gods, while the manipulation of Abraham continued. Gods maliciously planned and executed the full onslaught on Sodom and Gomorrah, the safe haven of the revolutionaries under the influence of Marduk, the rebellious god among the Anunnaki. Their slave Abraham had become a devoted and loyal servant who would do anything for his gods. God told Abraham that the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah was great, and the accusations against him were grievous. Then God had decided to come down and verify if it was so. He would destroy them completely. The gods instructed Abraham to go to the cities and spy on the people. With Abraham, three angels appeared to him, and Abraham pleaded with them. Two of these angels carried some sorts of weapons, and the third one was God himself in person. They made it very clear to Abraham that unless he can produce 50 virtuous men from the inhabitants of the two cities, the cities will be decimated. It would only be because he was asked to snoop around and report back to the gods. They now come to seek the results of his snooping. So Abraham was snooping around. And the gods have a non-negotiable plan to wipe out these rebels in these sinful cities. Abraham is their spy. Abraham's nephew Lot moved into Sodom prior to this, and he was the one who was leaking information about the evil, sinful people of the city to his uncle. So when the angel warriors arrived at the gate, they found Lot waiting for them. He took them to his house. But the word spread like fire, like wildfire, through Sodom that the violent angel were at Lot's house coming to attack them. So residents of Sodom recognized two angels immediately because they had seen them doing this before. Just another one of their regular appearances during which they inflicted pain and death on people. So carrying deadly weapons way beyond humans' understanding, this was a perfect opportunity for the people of Sodom to lynch the angels and have some level of revenge. The activists were joined by young and old, demanding that the angels come out. This was a perfect trigger for the violent gods to react. It was all the proof they needed to confirm that all the people of Sodom needed to be destroyed. Angels came out and smote the people with blindness. They told Lot to gather all his family members and to get out of the city as they were about to destroy it. And Lot was met with disbelief and ridicule. And in the end, only his wife and two daughters were the ones that fled the city with him under the cover of darkness. The angels told Lot, escape for your life. Look not behind thee, neither stop thou anywhere in the plain. Unto the mountains, escape, lest thou perish. Which means, get the hell out of here. Get to the mountains, hide in the caves. Well out of sight. So Lot pleaded with them to delay the destruction of Sodom long enough for him to reach the town of Zoar. But,
I should say, in a lot of the accounts...
On your mic, honey.
In some of the accounts of the Bible, it says that five cities were destroyed south of the the Salt Sea, which was turned to the Dead Sea, and they seem to have included in the list Zoar, but Zoar was not bombed. It was a place of refuge that Lot was heading for.
Okay, so then there was a nuclear holocaust. It only can be compared to a nuclear holocaust, which it was. Cities, the people, the vegetation, everything was upheavaled by the angels' awesome weapons. The heat and fire scorched everything in its path. Its radiation and pressure wave affected people quite a distance away. Lot was told to not look back and hide out of sight because an explosion of such magnitude would certainly blind one. And the radiation with the pressure wave and heat would incinerate life for miles away. This is exactly what happened to the disobedient and the inquisitive wife of Lot. And she was turned into a pillar of vapor, not a pillar of salt, which is what one would expect from a nuclear blast. So Lot may have been spying on other people in other cities. He was not allowed to stay because the citizens were familiar with Lot and his close links to the gods. They were scared of a similar fate to that of Sodom. The angels of death followed Lot from town to town, destroying one by one in the same fashion as Sodom. The anger of the innocent people throughout the lands boiled over, which fueled revolutionaries, causing thousands more to join the loud protest against the violent gods everywhere. So the cities have risen up in rebellion against the gods, one by one. And the gods simply responded with what they knew best, violence, death, and destruction of their disobedient slaves. And that is where we end today's episode. Wow, that was pretty heavy, honey.
Well, what they did was pretty heavy. I mean, we are just like cattle to them, at least we were then. Now their descendants have become more subtle and use economic slavery, but they still do war, and they still get us to war against each other with terrible weapons. And these people are not gods. These are just people from another planet. They were about 50 years ahead of where we are now in their technology, and they're mass murderers on the order of George Bush, you know?
Well, you know, you have to realize it's only been a year for them, you know? Their year is 3,600 years, and we're still looking on that, and this is what we're examining, what happened while they were actively interacting with humans. So God came down, which was Yahweh, which was Enlil, as one of the three quote-unquote angels, to check things out. So they were still walking around us. And so they obviously can kind of walk among humans and not draw that much attention.
Well, they're big guys. They are bigger. They are physically bigger. But there was a lot of mixed population anyway. But if you go back to the story of when at Marduk's wedding, when the Igigi astronauts each captured, there was 200 of them, each captured a woman from among the favored line of the Adapites, and they had children. The children, it says in the Bible, were giants like their father. And Goliath, as you'll see when we get down to King David, was one of these.
All right. Well, that's probably enough for today. A lot to digest, all you listeners.
Yeah, next time we're going to look at Abraham's descendants, how Abraham's grandson, actually a great-grandson, Joseph, saved Egypt and brought the Israelites into Egypt.
Right. So next time, this will be episode 34, and we're going to listen to Sitchin's descriptions of how Isaac's son, Jacob, also known as Israel, begat Joseph, who is the savior of Egypt, who in turn preserved the tribe of the Jews until Moses took them back to Canaan. So once again, this is Janet and Sasha Lesson, Dr. Sasha Lesson and Janet Kira Lesson from Aquarian Radio. Please go to our website, aquarianradio.com, and read more about this episode. Look at the YouTube, there's articles. And our book is there, Anunnaki, Gods No More. Please buy our book. And we are going to be co-presenting or co-sponsoring a conference in Las Vegas, June 7th, 8th, and 9th, called Stargate to the Cosmos. And the website isn't up yet. It'll be up in a couple more days. Just be patient, and you can begin registering it to attend. And Dr. Lesson and I are going to bring some of this information to a public venue to present. Do you have something to say, honey?
I forgot what it is.
He forgot what he's going to say.
Oh, I know what it is. Listen, do look at the website, www.enkispeaks.com, because there's this incredibly good YouTube that shows a whole three different versions of the, or maybe even four different versions of the story of Abraham, as it appears in the Quran, as it appears in the Old Testament, and some of the variations from parts of the Bible that didn't get that got edited out.
Right, so these stories, as they appear in the literature by Zechariah Sitchin and Michael Tellinger and other people like ourselves, paint a whole other picture, and you are the ones that can make the decision on what to believe or
incorporate. Well, it's a matter of Occam's razor. What information most parsimoniously simply accounts for the facts and predicts new facts when you're looking for them? And you'll see that these gods were not gods. They were people with high tech, and they were tall. And they probably had extended occipits.
And it made sense to me. I mean, I was raised with the Bible as the Bible. And when I started looking at this, I went, oh my goodness, this makes a lot of sense. All right, that's enough for today. Thank you very much for joining us. Aloha. Love and blessings from Maui, Hawaii.
Thanks for joining us today on Aquarian Radio. We broadcast daily and our schedule is on aquarianradio.com. Listen live by calling 646-649-0893, or you can listen live by calling 646-649-0893, or listen to our archives on aquarianradio.com. Join us again soon, and do tell your friends, the age of Aquarius and the paradigm of peace is now.
Aloha, this is Enki. You know me as Aquarius, and this is our age, the Satayuga. Time to celebrate with us. We have programs on all chakra tantra, love styles and relationship choices, counseling strategies and techniques that you can use at home. We have extraterrestrial radio, where we deal with alienology, paranormal people, and we have an experiencers network. We have a section called Ancient Aliens, and the programs therein are Enki Speaks, Nimma, the Mother of Humanity, has her program, and we revise ancient anthropology. And most important of all, we have peace paradigms, because this is the age of peace. Harmony and understanding, sympathy and trust abounding, no more falsehoods or derisions, golden living dreams of visions, mystic crystal revelations, and the mind's true liberation.
And this has been another episode here at AquarianRadio.com.
AquarianRadio.com.
Harmony and understanding, sympathy and trust abounding, no more falsehoods or derisions, golden living dreams of vision, mystic crystal revelations.